All right, wait a minute, wait a minute.
I'll get to it when we get to it. Don't worry about it. Doesn't matter.
Okay. Welcome to the open the town planning board workshop meeting. Anybody have anything for the agenda?
Oh, well, thank you for asking. I just have a quick thing about Mohonk.
Okay.
Yeah.
We'll put that down on hold. And Tom and I will give you an update of our trip out there.
Great. Oh, you guys went on a walk?
I was going to suggest...
No, not the walk.
Oh, okay.
Since it's sort of a workshop meeting, that maybe we could fold the table around just a little bit so we can see each other, you know, like it's sort of weird all sitting in a line here. Like,
we're talking...
Yeah,
yes.
We can just come around.
We could still be able to photograph if they just tip that, like...
Yeah, why don't we try that? We're going
to... Tipping?
Hold on.
Sorry. It just seems weird. You're looking down the line and you guys are moving on me too.
Okay. Oh, nice.
We'll just put our backs.
I like that we just stood here for the
whole time. I think we should do that all the time.
Yeah, well, that would be nice.
Then we could close it off and...
We can put it right in the front.
Trap me out.
That's right. I have a question for you.
Sure.
I understand, I don't know if it's something we want to talk about, that the town is talking about a moratorium in the Gateway District.
Well, I think they're talking about a committee to talk about.
What?
I think they're talking about a committee to talk about a moratorium.
What is the Gateway
in true bureaucratic style?
Neither do I.
It's a new term.
It's a new term, so nobody knows what that means. So we don't know what they're talking about. It's not moved forward. Nothing has happened, and it will probably come.
I think
that's what the committee would look at.
Right.
I have no idea.
It was raised up at a town board meeting.
And this is the town Gateway?
Well, a couple of things have to be decided on. What is the Gateway? What things are you looking at is in the Gateway District. You can't really, the benefit of a moratorium is you know what you want, you just haven't written the structure for the zoning to go through that, which requires public hearings, refer it to the county. So that's a process that takes time. So while you're going through that process, you declare a moratorium. But we're still, as I understand it, well back at the conceptual stage of what is the Gateway District? What do you want to allow? And what don't you want to allow? How does that work out? I go back with Augusta. It probably needs a committee to start fleshing it out.
Got it. Okay.
All right. Anything else for the agenda? Okay. First up is a review and approval of the April 11th, 2016 meeting.
I'll make a motion to approve the minutes.
I'll second that.
Any further discussion? All those in favor?
Aye. Aye.
And Carol's with a K. Okay. Okay. What we're trying to do in the workshop meetings and going forward, trying to schedule them out, is to work with either different committees, or in this case with Stacy, on some of the things that we see before us, or that's getting some playtime on it. One of the things, and Patty's here for it, we did just get the application for the Twin Star farm that we had just got in today. But I want Stacy to bring up to speed on some of the issues that are going on with the agricultural districts, and let you take it away.
Okay.
It's informal.
Go
ahead. All right.
In front of you, you have blue folders. In those blue folders, I put together a packet for you. In your packet, you'll notice that there are letters from Ag and Markets, dated April 22nd, November 16th, and there's a response by the town's attorney, Joe Muriello, and there are some guidance documents along with it. This is how we got here. A complaint was filed against the town of Ag and Markets because an individual wanted to put a farm market on a farm. Okay, so he filed his complaint with Ag and Markets. Whether his complaint was accurate or not, it didn't matter. It triggered a review of the town zoning ordinances. Okay, the second letter from Ag and Markets is what they found when they did a review of the town.
That would be on November 16th.
And what it basically said was, is it doesn't appear that your zoning ordinance is very friendly to farmers. You have a farmland preservation plan, and your zoning doesn't quite go hand in hand with your farmland preservation plan, which you all have a copy of. That's this large document here. We did respond to the letter. We indicated to Ag and Markets that yes, we need to do some work on our zoning ordinance. However, not to the we don't believe that we need to do as much as they feel we do. One of the things that they felt that we should not be doing is requiring site plans for farms, for farm markets, and things of that nature. And we politely told them yes, we do. Especially when you have a farmer who is on a county, the corner of a county road and a state road, a very high traffic area. You know, there are impacts, there are land use impacts. We have not received a response from Ag and Markets in regards to our letter of January 8th of this year. And we have not been fined or anything from Ag and Markets. So we're gonna keep moving forward with adjusting our zoning as necessary. And we're working with Ag and Markets to make sure that we're in compliance with the law. So,
was that on just farm markets or anything with a farm?
The issues are is that, you know, I can't issue a building permit unless it meets the waiver requirements and you approve the waiver. Okay, and not to mention that our site plan review process is very lengthy and very costly to applicants. That's not farmer friendly.
Yeah.
Okay. To have a farmer come in and spend 2 to 3 years in front of the planning board and spend $50,000 to have a site plan approved for a farm market is not farmer friendly. We say in our preservation plan that we want to preserve farms, and we want farms, and they're important to our community, so we need to look at our zoning to see how we can adjust it for that to happen. That is your
question. Yeah.
Makes sense.
So, but the farm market is what triggered that, okay? And you have agritourism now is another layer, okay? And there is valid agritourism that goes hand in hand with farms, and then there it gets a little
fake.
You know, well, it just gets a little out of control sometimes, so we need to take a good look at that as well. So I've given you guidelines from Ag and Markets in regards to guidance on farmers, on wind energy, okay, because we know all the farmers are using windmills and things of that nature. We've got some definitions in there of what their terminology is. The direct farm market activities, that is directly relative to farm markets. Okay, so so when we're looking at, you know, when we're looking at how we can be more friendly in the site plan arena, this may help. And there's some information on the startup farms and what have you. I included Ag and Markets 301, which is their definitions, There's a commentary in here that was in Town and Topics in regards to agricultural uses. One of the ways that I was thinking that we might want to take a look at farming in the community and what farmers need to sustain their farms, because this is where your agritourism kind of comes into play. You know, just growing crops and selling crops doesn't always work, especially for your smaller local farmers. And that's why we get into farm markets and things of that nature. One of the ways that I was thinking that we can take this process and shorten it up is to think along the lines of something like a simplified site plan for these uses. Because, you know, when you get into farm markets and things that are open to the public, you do have land use issues. You can have traffic issues, you can have lighting issues, you have signage issues. You know, they may be in the middle of a residential district. So, you know, they do need some form of review. But if the planning board came up with a guideline, like we do a simplified site plan, for farmers that says if they meet this criteria, you know, they're eligible for a waiver. You know, I was thinking something along those lines might be very, very helpful.
And uses of the farm market, how much, what's being sold at the farm market? Obviously, you know, you can start expanding that, you know, besides vegetables and things of other sorts.
And that's where your definitions come in, because once a farmer starts veering away from what is considered agriculture, it becomes retail. And Ag and Markets also says, yes, a farm market is retail, but they're selling what they're growing. Okay? And that was another issue that they had with our local zoning, is if you look at our use table, it allows agriculture in every district. Okay. However, when you sell your agriculture from a different lot, not allowed in some of the districts, you know, they're having a little bit of issue with that, because Ag and Market says to be a farm doesn't have to all be on one parcel.
Yeah.
So this draws a line of how far out do you bring additional things in, and then what are those additional things?
Mm-hmm. So they recognize the need for some form of, they do recognize the need for some form of land use approvals, you know, depending on what the scope of the project is. And they're saying, you know, make it more friendly for farmers. That, you know, do they really need to have full engineered drawings?
Mm-hmm.
You know, maybe perhaps they do, if you have, you know, highway line of sight issues and things of that nature. Otherwise, maybe they don't, you know. Maybe they can take a survey, a portion of a survey map that they have, and plot out where they want to put their market. And, you know, it's going to be, you know, my farm market's going to be, you know, a 15 by 15 shed. You know, that's much different than, let's say, the application frame that's coming in front of you. So.
What about the farms that now exist? Did they have to go through this process, the farm markets that now exist?
I can tell you that the farm markets that are legally out there right now have site plan approval, continue to get site plan approval, get building permits for what they need, because once it's open to the public, it's required to have a building permit. An agricultural building is a building that's used just for the storage of machinery, wares, not anywhere that anybody works, anything that's open to the public, anything of that nature. Okay, so Walkfield
Farms.
We have
a lot of food stand market,
right.
Farm markets.
Walkfield, I can tell you, Walkfield has, they have site plans. Apple Hill has site plans. What's his name out there? Dressel. You know, he has it. Well, I think he might be pre-existing.
Yeah, I think. Yeah, I don't think he's.
But he has approvals for other things that he's done out there. So, you know, yes. I mean, you know, we also have, our code also allows peddlers,
okay, without any licenses. So if you're peddling fish, meats, produce, you can pull your cart up alongside the road and you can sell whatever you want. Okay, period, end of story. Okay. It is interesting, and that was some of the issue we ran into with this complaint.
Is that like the food truck stuff, things like that as well? Does that
no,
count?
Food That's trucks different. Are different.
Like unless the they're selling in the freezer, selling space.
That's different. That's different. Okay, this is purely agriculture. Mm-hmm. You know, fruits, vegetables, meats.
On cooked, raw, right?
Yes.
I mean, that's what you're saying.
Right. Yeah.
So, and then there's the. I know that there's. It's not New Falls, but there's a farm that has weddings, things like that. Ag tourist.
Those are issues. Those,
and the neighbors are in uproars about it.
Those are issues. Ag and Markets is trying to sort those things out now. You know, you have to figure out if it's customarily incidental to the farm, okay? A wedding is not customary and incidental to a farm, okay? Or a farm market or whatever you want to classify it as. However, Ag and Markets is currently looking at this on a case-by-case basis, okay? Some of them, they have said yes, that would be agriculture, and I'll tell you why in a minute. And some of them, they have said no. If you can prove, okay, that a certain percentage of the revenue, okay, from a wedding is from the sale of your product, then they say yes, okay? But you have to prove it. And if it's not, it's no. So they did approve one or two. I think they approved one somewhere in Westchester County and one fairly local.
Oh, they approve everything down there.
You were the last one that read that. I lost that sheet. I couldn't find it today. And I said, I just had somebody read it. What I did do with it, I don't know what I did with it. So it's on a real case-by-case basis.
And this may not happen in New Paltz, but wineries, where they actually grow grapes.
If it's a farm.
Yes, I understand.
Yep.
Like if they grow grapes,
yep.
Right? Mm-hmm. Which I don't think we have that here. But they do have it in West Park. I don't know if they still do. And they have weddings.
They have weddings up there, right?
And things. So, I mean, it would be a concern. That's what I'm saying.
They have to prove the sale of their product. So if you have a wedding in a winery, okay, if they're making enough money off of mm-hmm. the wine that they're producing for the winery and any foods that they're growing or anything like, yes, okay, but it's done on a case-by-case basis. So mm-hmm. yes, this is something that we need to look at very carefully, mm-hmm. very carefully. You know, I don't know that creating a mini amusement park on a farm, you know,
yeah.
is...
but a corn maze.
Definitely a corn maze.
See, pick and choose.
But a corn maze is pretty clearly like an agricultural thing. Like go-karts pretty clearly aren't. You know, but what do I know? Could be go-karts and a corn maze, I guess.
Yeah, well, the combination. Well, I always think it's... You can spell out some of it, but you can't really get down to the nuts and bolts.
I mean, if you have a farm where you grow fruits and vegetables and you have livestock and you have a petting zoo, I would say, yeah, that would be accessory to the farm because those are the animals that are generally on the farm.
But if you're selling watermelon in June, would you think that would be important?
It doesn't necessarily matter that it's not grown on the lot.
Mm-hmm. If it's grown in Georgia or someplace like that.
I mean, Walk Hill View sells very little of their own stuff. You know, I think it's a great market. I love it, but I don't know if there's regulation for that. I mean, they are a farm, obviously.
I used to work for Green Market in New York City.
They're really strict.
The farmers, we found that over half of them picked their stuff up right at Hunts Point.
I've heard of this.
Brought it to the farmers market.
In Hawaii, I go to a farmer's market where everything's from Costco.
I don't think it matters that, you know, I sell product that you grow. And you see that in our farm markets. Our farmers talk to each other. Okay, I know that some of our farmers sell other farmers' cider.
But that is a farm product.
Other farms teaches.
Yeah, but it's not from, like, you know, Portugal or something.
You can't regulate that, you can't enforce it, and I don't think under ag markets law, it, you know,
they don't care. Okay.
Fruits, fruits and veggies, it's the protection of farmland. It doesn't really matter where the farmland is. If it all goes away, there won't be any.
Well, in that sense, Stop and Shop is a farm market, like, because it's pretty, you know.
No, Stop and Shop is a supermarket.
Well, I mean, if they don't care where the things are from, you know.
Understand the definition of a farm.
Yeah.
Okay, so if you're a farm, and you sell other farm products,
yeah,
it doesn't matter where it comes from.
Gotcha. So you could be farming corn and selling it to wherever, and then bringing in 100% of your stuff for your farm market, and it doesn't matter. Right. Just want to be clear. Okay, cool.
Generally, when you think of some of these farm markets, it's the variety of stuff that they necessarily would have to have, like you just said.
Yeah,
work of,
totally.
Yeah, I mean, if you need onions, but you may not want to grow or have a spot to grow onions, so you're going to bring them into from somewhere else on it. So, and people that go shopping there, if Fort Kalani grew corn,
yeah, people wouldn't go there.
Wouldn't go there. They would buy something else. So the idea is for a farm market is, and that's the farm to table. Even what we talked about having a wedding and serving the food there, that it's all locally grown. It doesn't have to be locally grown on that farm per se. So you see how it gets kind of
in that case, yes. Yeah. In that case, in the case of a wedding at a farm, okay, we'll use a local farm, and I'm just, because I know he does farm to table, we'll use Bradley's farm. If Bradley decides to have weddings, okay, the product has to be his.
Mm-hmm.
He's got to grow it. It's got to come from his farm. Now, it doesn't have to come from that lot. If he has a farm in New Paltz and a farm in Gardner and a farm in Plattekill and a farm in, you know, somewhere in Dutchess County, as long as it's his product and he can show that he raised the product and, you know, that's what he used and that's where the majority of the sale came from, then, yeah, ag markets will certainly back that.
Yeah.
Well, I just can't imagine at a wedding that everything people eat are going to be.
No, I think it's
that's
a percentage.
Why, and it's,
it was
that's 50%. That's why Agri Market uses a percentage.
Yeah. Okay. But I've been to weddings like that. Yeah. See, farm table. People learn lots about it.
Getting back to
our definition of Agri Markets. Our definition of agriculture, we don't have one in our zoning code, okay? In chapter 140-8, which is, 140-4, which is our definitions, our general definitions for zoning, we do not have a definition of agriculture. We do have a definition of agriculture in the clearing and grading law. Our definition of agriculture should absolutely match the definition of agriculture for ag markets.
So
that's something that has to be changed.
Yeah.
That's the first.
Is that definition person. Here? Do we have it here?
Yes.
But what I'm going at is taking the simple approach and seeing what we can streamline from a checklist point of view to say, is there an issue there or not an issue, like we do in a simplified site plan. Stacy mentioned a couple, and I just, you know, want you to think out about it, but if someone wanted to set up farm stand, regardless of where it is, what are some of the things that are important? To me, I agree. Where it is, traffic-wise, can the people get off the road and onto this site? And how big is it? Is how many cars and parking associated with it? I got lighting and hours of operation. But I'm just trying to think going forward on it. Seasonal operation too. If they're going to be there, July, August, and September, and maybe in Columbus Day and close down, that might be something else you would want to consider. But if you can check off the boxes and say these don't have any impacts, or there's no question from a site plan that they can do that, you could streamline the process for them coming in for a short duration. I think if they came in for 3 months, would have a better or faster processing than if they were coming in to be a permanent installation.
I'll tell you what happened in New York City is, for example, there was a farmer's market in Union Square years ago. I don't know if it's still there or not. Mm-hmm. But so those farmers would set up 1 day during the week and 1 day on the weekend, and basically they would pay like $10 or something for a parking space, for a table and stuff. Meanwhile, Korean grocers all around the square were paying for the building and paying for insurance and garbage and all these other services. And they were all buying their food at the same place, you know? So, for example, if a farmer's market came across the street from my market, like, he's going to be at a disadvantage. He has much higher costs.
Infrastructure
just setting up a tent on the weekend.
Well, so then that should be something in our list is like how much, if we can regulate this, what percentage of what you're selling is from your farm? So it doesn't become just like a undercutting whatever local store by, buying stuff at Costco or whatever and selling it super cheap.
I understand we're not talking about farmers markets. We're talking about farm markets. We're talking about a farmer's market is something that you set up somewhere in somebody's
parking lot.
We're talking about legitimate farmers. Okay, we're talking about farms as defined.
So the market.
Okay. My last comment was still standing. In that case, a farmer's farm stand or a farmer's market would have the same impact on.
But they have to be a farm. It has to be a farm. Okay.
But in here, it's saying it doesn't have to be located where.
But it doesn't have to be on the farm.
So the definition of you have to understand the definition of farm, okay, and agriculture, okay. All agricultural operations and activities related to the growing or raising of crops, livestock or livestock products, and agricultural products, as such terms are defined in or governed by the Ag and Markets Law of the State of New York, on lands qualified under Ulster County and New York State law for an agricultural exemption by the assessor of the town.
Yeah, but so I think what Lyle's saying is like, so even though you have to be a farm to open a farm stand, is your point, but the farm stand doesn't have to be at the farm, right? So it could be like...
Well, if the farm stand is not at the farm,
yeah,
then it's a retail operation, period.
We're talking about setting up
at the farm. But right. Even still, okay, so let's say, you have like Ray Bradley's farm. Well, I guess it's on Springtown Road, so it's different, but like... you set up a farm stand under these regulations and you are a farm, but then you just go buy all your stuff. There's nothing we can do to like regulate
that. But he's
that.
An active farm and he needs the definition. He's got his 7 acres. He's out there farming. There's a clear distinction between a retail operation and a farm. And that was the issue we had with Rivendell Winery.
Yeah.
Rivendell Winery, they wanted to have their winery, but they didn't have a farm.
Yeah. It's pretty funny, like, if you do have a farm, you can kind of just do whatever then. Like,
you work for Ag and Markets still?
I'm just working it through in my head.
The commentary, take a look at the commentary that's in your packets.
Okay.
And that kind of
that article I read.
How far is too far?
Yeah, exactly.
Right.
Well, I think that's what Lyle said.
New
what was that?
Yeah.
So any farmer now, for example, can put his little farm on three trucks in front of his farm without a permit because it's a peddler, right? I mean, right?
No, he can't. According to our zoning law, he can't sell from the lot without getting planning board approval.
Oh, but he can sell in the street.
But he can take his cart up to...
ShopRite.
Where they, you know, anywhere. The Wildberry Lodge, where the guy sells the Christmas trees there, okay, he was exempt, and he can sell there legally. According to our code, he can legally do that.
But he can't sell off his own lot.
He can't sell off his own lot, and that's a problem in our code.
Yeah, okay. That's weird.
Gotcha.
So let's change that.
Well, those are the kinds of things that we're going through. I think, you know, again, rather than try to get into the specific languages of it, because then we'll bury ourselves, what I'm looking forward is trying to get an idea of what are some of the things from a site plan point of view that would be something the planning board would want to take a look at or a sign off on it, or that if he meets, the farmer meets the requirements, then we really don't have to see it from a site plan point of view. I think reading through some of the stuff and then seeing how the farmers markets generally operate and where they operate probably will trigger some important things that you want to make a decision on, or you want to see some more facts than just a sketch plan. But others, he's off a local road, he wants to put it up, he's going to operate, you know, 3 or 4 months a year, and he's going to sell tomatoes when they're in season. I mean, we really don't need a site plan for something like that. That's what I'm just trying to get the thought process going here. Just like, again, from our point of view,
but do you have,
can we make something
up? Yes, but do you cap the size of the building that he's allowed to make for his tomatoes and other products? Because, or can he just go to Stacy and say, I want a building permit for a 6,000 square foot building, and I'm going to sell fruit and vegetables out on my farm? So, I mean, to me, that is different. And someone could say, well, it says I don't need to come to the planning board. So, and I'm only going to sell fruits and vegetables in my 6,000 square foot building. I mean, I think you have to look at all of that.
Well, that's what Mike is saying. Where do you think the line is? You know, do you think the line is, he's looking at putting up a 1,500 square foot building, 1,000 square foot, where he's going to store some of this product and sell some of this product from. Do we really need to see that? You know, it's on a back road. There are, no site issues. Quiet street, not a whole lot of traffic. You know, is this something we really need to see? Or, is this something bigger that we need to look at? I think that's what Mike's saying. Where do we want to, kind of like we did with our site plan waivers. If there's no water, additional water usage, and there's no additional parking, there's none of this, there's none of that, then we really don't need to look at it. Like if it comes to a change of use or something of that nature. That's kind of what Mike is saying. Can we pull something together?
Yeah,
like that?
And again, you're right. If someone came in and said, I'm going to put in, I'm going to sell products, I'm a farmer, and I want to put up a 6,000 square foot building, I think we have something substantial here that we, from a site plan point of view, that we should look at the issues that are associated with it.
So that's
why I'm only worried about unintended consequences if we put out something too general.
I mean, if I come to you and say, I want to establish, a farm-to-table restaurant, that's going to seat 200 people, that's something you have to look at. But if I'm going to do farm-to-table that's going to seat 15 people a meal, we're going to do a meal on Saturdays and Sundays.
So how do we note that? How do we note that distinction?
Well, I think we talk around.
But it's not that there's not going to be parking or traffic or utilities. The impacts are going to be low.
But also, you don't know how things will grow.
There's going to be a much different impact on a farm to table that's going to sit 15 people than there is on, you know, a farm to table restaurant that's going to seat 200. Very, very different.
And again, what we're trying to do, and it doesn't say that we're casting stone, but put out a site, a size, and then take it around. And obviously, it's a zoning change. Obviously, if it's a zoning change, then it's a public hearing associated with it. And
well, I was going to say, like, I think this is a great discussion. I think, well, one, maybe we should be keeping a list of code changes, like inconsistencies and things that could we, like, I still don't really know how that works, like send a letter to the town board to deal with or whatever. But also I feel like, not to drag this out so much, but what if we talk to some farmers to see, because I'm sure they would know so much more than us, like what their problems are and how, you know, we can best kind of like help them run their business, or not run their, you know, succeed, but also balance that with what we need to see. I just feel like that might be really useful.
I kind of agree with you. I mean, I can say, you know, if a farmer needs to put up an 8-foot-high fence because the deer are devastating their crop, they actually have to go to the ZBA for a variance.
Right.
Yeah. It's like stuff like that.
In my opinion, that's ridiculous.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Yeah, I mean, I'm sure if we
but
brought
if
three farmers here, they could
farm
just say,
and
like,
deer being channeled into your yard by that 8-foot-tall fence, I think that's an issue.
But if we're trying to protect farmland and the deer are coming in and devastating the crops.
The farmland is, you're saying that the farmland is worth more to society than this person's
No, what I'm saying is, what I'm saying is very important to us.
No, I'm not saying it's unimportant. I'm just saying that.
But.
That 8-foot-tall fence, which seemed like nothing, can have devastating effects on somebody else.
What you would do with that is, if that 8-foot fence is by a road, it doesn't impact anybody, then you would say, yeah, they don't need a variance for it. But if it's in a residential area or it impacted neighbors, then you would want to review it to see what kind of impacts it would have.
Well, if you had a house and you were going to put up the fence around your house to protect your ornamentals or your garden or whatever, you would have to have a permit.
Regardless, you would need a permit. Yeah.
I do think that's more important.
Yeah. I'm just trying to get threshold levels of when we would see it and when we wouldn't.
And when you put them up on the road, that can keep the deer on the road longer and increase the chance of hitting a deer, because they're walking down the road to the next
next opening.
Opening, you know.
But then also, when they go to the ZBA, is the ZBA like, you know, you're on a road, you're next to houses, blah blah, so you can't build this fence, and then the farm folds? Like, what's even the purpose of them going to the ZBA? Is it always approved? Is it always,
I can't tell you one or the other. I know there's a number of 8-foot fences out there, but again, I think, you know, we can argue both sides of the coin easily enough on all of these things. And all I want to do is be able to
think
a little forward, and then it's easier for the applicant if he knows what's allowed, what's not allowed for any application.
But
the more we can define some of this stuff, or at least set up a draft to be kicked around like the proverbial football, it may be helpful to get that kind of input. But I want to put something up that's kind of realistic.
I think this is a really delicate position we're in, because I feel like already in town we hear so much, and I know this, that like people don't want to, will do anything to avoid coming to the planning board, because, you know, it seems like we penalize people who want to go through the right channels, because like ShopRite, you know, like they just want to, it's not a small thing, they want to redo their facade, and then obviously the parking lot is terrible, so then it triggers like a whole huge thing. And I feel like with farmers, like, we don't want to penalize people who are trying to get their permits and do everything the right way by saying, oh, here's this other new list of things we just came up with, you know. So I just feel like we got to tread, like, we got to figure out what makes sense, which is obviously what we're trying to do. I'm just saying, like, this is an important thing.
How does other towns, surrounding towns, handle it? I think we should really take a look at what they have done.
We are probably the most restrictive.
Sounds like us.
You know, I did make a call to Sawgreaves, and they're very relaxed in their agricultural laws. There aren't many.
Again, is it?
So, you know, maybe we should look at surrounding towns mm-hmm. and sort of pick and choose how we can develop our own plan and work off other people's mistakes.
But it also, like I said, and you know, this is going to be an important document too, because whatever we do should follow this plan.
Yeah.
The Farmland Preservation Plan, right.
I mean, also, property values are getting so crazy here that, you know, it's like we're squeezing farmers out more and more.
Give them the option, right. If they can't make it farming, they can make it sell them property. You don't want to do that. That's not the preservation
plan. That's contrary
to the plan.
Yeah.
But I think just trying to come up with, what thresholds are we concerned about, or we think we can set some bogeys for, and then where and what should those thresholds be? We'll scour up a couple of local zoning codes. We'll see where we can dig up and get that to the board. But I'd like you to read through the material see how we can, again, streamline it for the farmer wants to put in a farm stand and or on a property and sell products, that he doesn't have to go through our site plan if you meet certain conditions.
I think like that's the basics, right?
Right.
Is that a farmer can sell the stuff he grows in a farm stand on his property. I mean, that's the basics. I mean, that should, they shouldn't have to come, I think, if anything, for that simple thing, they shouldn't have to come before us. They want to sell what they grow
they
in a farm stand.
They do, because that, I mean, that
right, so I'm saying that would at least be the basics of what it is, and maybe come up with a size based on the size of their farm, you know, the farm, the building they can have, or something like that, without coming before us. Does that make sense?
Well, that's
yeah.
It's a start, I think. You'll find, and we have to talk further on it, maybe this application will give us some information on it, but I think generally the farms are growing specific crops, and to sell off the farm stand, and for you to stop, you know, they may need to bring in other stuff to make it a complete store, you know. I don't grow tomatoes, or one of them is to
peat moss.
Yeah, we were, you know, so I think some of that is what makes a farm stand, what are those crops that come in. You know, we always think of the classic one, it's apple picking season. Oh, you got all kinds of different apples, and the farm stands out there to sell the apples that come off the farm, and that's the kind of straightforward on it. But, some of these things are selling additional things during that time, mainly for you know, additional revenue and different sources to draw people in on it. But you know, I'm not
T-shirts.
Sure what those are. You know, it's
like where's the line on that?
Yeah,
yeah, totally.
We need to think about that. I think it's like sort of like an accessory uses type thing. Okay, if it's like honey, if it's baked goods, if it's
cranberry nut bread,
you know, different things like that become sort of like accessory to the farm stand, but gravel and things like that might be, you know.
I'm just so wary of what we're even talking about, because I feel like, you know, we're telling farmers, like, you know, sometimes you have to bring in, like, apples could be like your loss leader, and you have to bring in something with a higher profit margin. And I feel like, I don't know, it just seems so worrying to be like, you can sell this, you can't sell that. On the other hand, I think there are definitely some farm markets around here that I feel are kind of like scammy, because they make you think that it's all like local produce and there's pretty much none. So I'm really
on both sides. They're all going down to Hunter's Point.
There's a lot of information in the packet that I gave you. Read through it. That's going to help clarify some of those issues for you.
Yeah. All right. I see both sides very clearly. That's all I'm saying.
That's scary. Okay. But again, what I, you know, I think from our point of view, and helping Stacy in moving zoning to a, for agricultural farm stands, that we should try to come up with some sort of threshold levels of what we're thinking of. Now, like I said, yeah, I agree. We don't have any farmers on the board, so we may not have a good understanding of it. But I think it's something good that to go out, at least for getting discussion purposes.
Yeah.
We've done that in a number of other areas where we didn't have a clue, but we thought this was the right thing to do, and then get batted back and forth from both sides of the equation. But then that's how you come up with something that's workable on it.
You might want to reach out. Little John Ferrante recently graduated from Cornell, to be the next generation, all right? Mm-hmm. You might want to talk to him about what they see that's coming forward. Just to kind of get a handle on those questions that you had earlier.
Okay. I talk to farmers every day, so I'll talk.
All right, talk to again. It's, I think there are a couple, yeah, that's reason for the workshop is really just to kick off some areas that we got to get involved with from a planning perspective and get at least some of our zoning updated to the 21st century. You know, reading it, it takes a lot to change it, and we just add on. So. I think this is one of the areas, that's why I talked to Stacy, that's one of the areas that's coming quickly down the pike, and I'd rather we at least take a threshold shot at it before we get forced to accept something that it's really not the right thing, and then try to work around it after that. And again, I'm not looking for a lot of hard and fast stuff, but a workshop in May, I'm going to ask, go around and see if we have some ideas for what would be thresholds, again, from a simplified site plan or farm stand permitting process. Right now, as Stacy said, if he wants to put up a farm stand, it's a site plan approval. So what I'm trying to do is say, what can we do to simplify that? So I think two areas, what are some of the thresholds that we would consider if we, that would require our review? And then if you do come up with some thresholds, what's the level of that threshold? In other words, if traffic is an issue, is it on a state highway or a county highway or a town road? That could be, you know.
Well, another possibility might be to develop some kind of a simplified site plan review type thing that we use to implement those
right.
Small uses so that it didn't go to engineering and major expenses for people, but we still had some sense that the building was safe and that egress to the building off the highway was safe. I mean, I know it puts more onus on your department, well, but it is a possibility of a way of.
You know, it's like with our simplified site plan process. You know, I work with the town engineer on those things. You know, with this is something that we would work with the highway superintendent and potentially the town engineer or even the planning board chair. It doesn't even have to be the town engineer; it could be the planning board chair. I mean, it all depends on how you kind of want to structure it. You know, I just ask that as you're going through this process, you have one application in front of you, you have another one coming. Just be mindful so that we stay out of the crosshairs of animals. Just be mindful through your process.
I think the timing is like Stacy said, timing is apropos because we have one before us now and we'll get another one in. And you can ask yourself those questions as you're going through it. Does this trigger a site plan review or doesn't for this area or this area? Now, there may be enough in there that says yeah, for this case, we want to do a site plan review because of this, this, and this, but these other areas, it doesn't cross the threshold, and then you, in your own mind, you've decided a threshold for certain areas of review. So,
even to the fact that you have an existing farm that has a farm market, and they want to put up another flower house. I don't want to call it greenhouse, but another flower house where they're going to sell, you know, their flowers and plants and whatnot in the spring. You know, does that really need to come to the planning board? Yeah. You know, so it's not just new stuff. It's, you know.
I'm going to take my 200 square foot shed that I sell my tomatoes out of it and change it into a 6,000 square foot shed where I'll have a lot more tomatoes.
And weddings.
And weddings. So, I'll give you a month, take a look at it. It will be one of the things I just want to kick around at the next workshop to see what we've come up with, and then we'll spend a little bit of time on that going forward. So read it over. Like Stacy said, we have one application in-house. We'll get another one soon. And I think it's, you can take a practice run at it. And again, this isn't hard and fast, and it certainly needs comments from people that do these things for a living. So, okay, is there anything else on that one that you want?
If you have any questions, call me.
Okay.
Or send an email. Emails are quick.
I was always had in the back of my mind that eventually I'd have to get back to the sign ordinances because signs are changing rapidly, even as we speak. The LED signs, the ones that are changing now, different colors, moving targets, things of that sort. We don't have anything in code that kind of discusses that. While I was thinking all this thing through, things outside that whole area have changed, where this is now more of a back burner than the front burner on it. And I'll let Stacy get you up to date on contents.
Yeah,
this isn't about square footage, okay?
Not necessarily, no. In your red packet, you have two documents. One is a copy of our local zoning law. The other is a synopsis of a Supreme Court ruling in Reed versus Gilbert from 2015. In a nutshell, what this says is that you cannot prohibit signs based on content.
Is that something we ever did?
Well, if you have a political sign,
You're
up before election, and the day after election, you'll notice your loop holes are all gone.
Yeah. Oh.
Okay.
This has thrown communities into a tizzy.
There's a law that says they have to be gone?
Yes.
I always wondered about that.
Oh.
But now that's unconstitutional, according to the Supreme Court.
Yeah, and it was unanimous. However, okay, it was a 3-3-3 split decision on what is considered content. So this document that you have kind of goes through it, and it talks about content-neutral signs. It talks about, you know, what justices, you know, took the real hard line on it, who was kind of in the middle. You know, one of the... one of the justices says, you know, like off-premise signs. Well, in order to know if a sign, if it's an off-premise sign, you have to read the content. Okay, one judge is saying, well, then you can't prohibit it. But they stood unanimous in the lawsuit, okay? So everybody's still kind of trying to feel their way, and I guess it'll get tightened up more and more as more people sue over signs. That's really what's going to happen. However, our sign law is, it's a tough law. It's a tough law to follow. But it is filled with things that now it can't be filled with.
Is the village and the town, how close are the laws on that? Do you know off the top of your head?
No, curious. I don't.
Okay.
Okay. Our law has some really good things in it. You know, like I said, but there's a lot of things that need to be re-looked at and refixed, and this is probably going to take some time. The biggest issue we're having right now is, like Mike said, we're getting a lot of requests for digital signage. I do not believe that digital signage meets the code, okay? Because the light bulbs don't have the opaque covering to be interior illuminated, so they don't meet the code.
I mean, by definition, it's interior illuminated. It's like a box.
Well, again, this isn't that old. I should went through a lot of gyrations, but signage is moving at a faster pace than our laws. So it's a catch-up on this.
Right, and the Reed decision says, like, you can't say just gas stations can have digital signage for their pricing. Reed says you can't do that. Because that's content. You can regulate the shape of the sign, the size of the sign, the color of the sign, where it goes. You can regulate all those things. But you can't regulate a sign based on what it says. You can't regulate it based on commercial and nonprofit. It gets a little tricky in here on that, okay? So it's gotta, you know, you can't say nonprofits can have have a temporary banner and Stop and Shop can't.
And we've had temporary banners across the board.
But we could say temporary banners can be up for a week, but we can't say that.
You can.
Okay.
Right.
Because a banner's not a sign?
It's a temporary sign. Temporary. You're allowed.
Okay.
In our code, we have temporary signs.
But you can't say you can't have this type of signage, but you can have
a banner.
Murals and stuff, they address that in here too.
Yeah,
and our code clearly has an exception for murals and things of that nature.
So now that's so not the case.
That's correct.
Oh, I had a long-term plan for a mural. Oh, I'm in the... Okay, whatever.
Right.
Sorry. It's a personal thing.
Well, it doesn't mean that your mural is not exempt. It could potentially mean that all the other issues are now allowed, that were prohibited. So, you know, that's where we're at. But I think the biggest thing right now that we're looking at are these digital signage. You know, does the town want to move to that? If they do want to move to that, do they want them to move? Do they want them in color?
Readability. And during the day and at night.
Well, to me, this goes to community character. We're a town that thrives off tourism and our historical buildings and our nature, and I don't think signs like that are in keeping with our community character. I'm going to be that snob.
Why are you doing those signs right now? Digital signs.
The only, the high school put one up, they're exempt. The high school put one up.
They're exempt? What do you mean?
They're exempt. They're exempt from our zoning.
Yeah, zoning, yes.
Okay, so the high school has one. Stewart's has a gas sign that's digital. Only the numbers, though, not the actual Stewart's sign, only the numbers. And there is one, the closest one that I know of, there is one out on
$2.99. Oh no, I read, but that's not New Falls.
It's not New Falls, but you want to know who falls.
And there's also one out in Platte Hill or Modena at the corner.
A lot of fire stations have them.
Yeah, that's right.
There's a church in Modena that is utilizing it.
So you can't, let me get this straight, just a little bit. You can't say that the fire station can have one and no one else can.
That's correct.
Okay.
And that's pretty clear in this document that you have on Reed versus Gilbert. It's pretty clear. There's, you know,
but we can say that we don't want them at all.
Yes.
Well, I have a study at home that's about the LED signs and the intensity and the distraction to drivers and the distance and the brightness and all that. Like, there's been a lot of work being done on it, you know, so it's just what New Paltz wants to do with that information. Mm-hmm. Isn't there a bank that has a temperature thing or something on it too? There used to be a bank with temperature.
That was in the village. Yeah.
That was the village bank has it. Yeah. That been out there. Time and temperature is on that sign for.
And yeah, but again, that's one of the things that we're getting asked about, questioned about. It's showing up. Like I said, right past high school, and that's from the time you come over the hill. I think it changes message at least twice, and maybe three times. I love how fast that thing is changing. I can see it change. I can't read it yet, but then I can see it change again. So
what sign? The car place?
At the high school. The high school sign.
Gotcha.
How often? It's like Lyle said, it is a distraction. How fast does it change? And things of that sort.
Do we have any applications before us for a digital sign right now?
Because the question comes first. I have said that they're not permitted, they don't meet the requirements of the code.
Because of being internally illuminated or why? Just curious.
Lighted signs are, internally illuminated signs are prohibited in our code with an exception. So they don't meet, except for an exception, so they don't meet that criteria.
Gotcha.
Okay. And the criteria, if you want to know what the criteria is, this is prohibited signs. Internally illuminated signs, except those with opaque background, semi-transparent letters, and the average level of illumination measured at 3 inches from the vertical surface, not exceeding 3 foot foot candles, and utilizing LED fixtures. So the Rite Aid sign meets town code. Stop and Shop sign, ShopRite sign, all these signs meet town code. Pasquale's, Dunkin' Donuts, they're internally illuminated, but they meet that criteria.
So why is there a problem with the code?
Because people want those.
Oh no, there are a lot of problems with this code.
No, this code, the sign code.
Yeah, there are a lot of issues with the sign code. But one of the biggest problems that we're running into right now is we're being asked about internally illuminated signs. Okay, or we're being asked about digital signs.
Yeah.
So I'm looking at this and I'm saying, well, it's not really an internally illuminated sign because the sign itself is the light bulbs.
Yeah.
Yeah. So this is technology has changed from when we were writing the code. When the code was written, they didn't exist. The LEDs signs didn't exist. So now we're facing with it and. I think what we have to do is come up with some language.
That sounds like no digital signs.
Well, something.
But
there could be.
The way a digital sign is constructed, based on our zoning code, I had to make a determination.
Mm-hmm. You would like it to be just clearer.
And it needs to be clearer.
I think there's a very nice way of doing a digital sign, which could save energy and could look nice and isn't like just a neon flashing thing in your eyeball. So it seems like, but then how do we draw that distinction?
Well, you can. You can. How often does that change?
Yeah.
And does it have a movement in it? Or is it just a, then it changes, mm-hmm. and it changes another message?
Like lumens, you know, the brightness.
Oh, and the brightness, yeah.
The brightness of it, you know, no white.
Yeah.
This is why we're here in front of you.
And the intensity of those LED signs with multiple small elements may not be less expensive than a more traditional illumination. You know, like LED is because it's bright, it puts out a lot of light. But when you're putting them into whole blocks, I'm not sure that that's they can still be thousands of watts powering those.
Yeah.
Thousands.
But again, the technology is improving all the time. So who knows if in.
I think it's the advantage is being able to change the message.
Yeah, totally.
I can see advantages. Gas stations, movie theaters.
Yeah.
Drive-through restaurants. I mean, these are all places that would utilize, the LED technology. Churches, firehouses, schools. I mean, they would all utilize that. Okay, the way I see it out there in the world today. It's just, do we want it or not? And if we do want it, how are we going to regulate it so that we don't have what is down the road?
That's the worst thing I've seen.
Right. Yeah. That's a Las Vegas sign.
Don't want that too many.
We don't want Las Vegas signs.
Well, again, you know what you don't want.
Yeah. So could we work out? I don't know how to say, like, the brightness, like, what level? You know, is there, like, some kind of...
What do you have while on that?
I think it was something from Ulster County Planning Board. I'll bring it in.
Okay.
I'll bring it in. I'll digitize it and send it to Kelly.
Yeah, and just take a look at it. I think what we want to do is draft up a potential for an LED. I want to read over the Supreme Court decision on... and read and see what kind of challenges we face with the signs and what we have to change on that.
So this is really two different issues. One is, do we want to allow digital signs? And
yes.
One is, our sign code is totally unconstitutional.
Well, I would say it's totally.
It's not totally.
Okay.
But when you look at your prohibited signs,
yeah.
Okay, when you look at your signs that are exempt, mm-hmm. when you look at your signs that are prohibited, you're going to see that we have issues in regards to the Reed decision. So we need to.
But yeah, just bringing those in together.
Right. And then, some other issues that we have is that, this code does not, other than temporary seasonal farm stands, okay, it does not address any signage for farmers.
Hmm.
Okay. It does not address new signs for new businesses in residential districts, only existing businesses. So we're going to need to fill some of those gaps. And I can give you a list of those, those other issues that are in our sign code.
So I think the takeaway for the signage is Lyle will get us a writing and we'll look what's going on with LEDs. I know Highland was working on it 6 months ago, maybe more than that, but I haven't seen a revised zoning ordinance, so I'm not sure where they're at.
You want me to see if I can get something from Highland?
Okay, yeah. Because they're the ones on 299, and I heard that they were getting a number of requests for the LEDs.
A sign like that, you have to wonder, like, at what point does a sign come with video,
Times Square.
There's some distinction there, but I'm not sure exactly.
Well, we, I mean,
when you don't have it defined, you get away. Yeah.
We might want to say, no moving signs, or it can't move for like a minute or something, where it's not just like, you know, and then because that's a video.
Yeah, well, that's the whole idea of, like Stacy read, the internally illuminated. You could specify foot candles on it. You could specify how often the sign changes. You could specify that
colors.
It's not anything moving on it. There's nothing guy running across the sign.
And whatever you do, you have to remember something. It has to be enforceable. So if you're going to say a sign can move, okay, but it can only move once every 5 minutes, that's not something that we're really going to be able to enforce unless it's, you know, because we go out there and it doesn't move.
Yeah.
We leave and it starts, you know, we go out there and it doesn't move. So, you know, make sure that whatever you're looking at is something that we can enforce.
So would you prefer either just a yes or no on moving signs? Is that
No, it's I don't prefer anything.
Yeah, but like
you're on the planning board and, you know.
Well, yeah, just in terms of enforceability, thinking about what.
You don't want to put in, I agree with you, you don't want to put something in there. But if we, I think we got to do a little bit more reading on it, but the moving signs are more of a, Miles said it's more of a distraction.
Yeah.
When your eyes are going down the road here, driving at night.
Well, and when you look at the local code, you're going to notice that on your prohibited signs, specifically they talk about no moving parts, no flags. Mm-hmm. You know that flag. You know, like carnival flags, like car dealerships put out. You know, those are all prohibited, and they're all been prohibited because it is a distraction to drivers.
Yeah. Well, and I saw there's you can't have a sign that says like stop or caution.
That's
or
correct.
Yep.
One way or something.
Wait, isn't there one of those inflatable ones that pops up out on 299?
I've seen those things. Usually from a used car dealership in Jersey.
I think there was one in 299.
Yeah, but I don't believe it's Nichols.
No. Oh, the little dancers? Dancer wiggly?
Yeah.
It could very well. They could frighten me. And I'm not afraid of a lot of things, but those things, I really. There's something about them that I just.
Just make sure you never get towed.
Okay, so the action item is Stacy's going to check in with Island. I'd ask you to read over that. Maya will get some information to Kelly. I think what I want to see out of this is some of the things that we would see or not see or we should be aware of in accepting LED signs that we want to see into a code and not. And then we can take that from there. Like I said, the high school one is up, and I go down Putt Corners on a regular basis, so.
It's the Illinois Coalition for Responsible Outdoor Lighting. IllinoisLighting.org. It gives you a lot of recommendations. It describes everything. It looks pretty good. Yeah, and they have a whole, their summary describes a lot of things of what they do. It goes through everything we just talked about, so.
Well, if you got the URL, send it out to Kelly and she can get it out to everybody. Mm-hmm. Then we can go do it there.
Solar, your yellow packet.
Was that apropos or I just waited when you said that now? I just realized.
My budget's taking a hit with all these folders. Let's see. Okay. Well, I don't know how many of you know this, but your solar companies have become somewhat predator-like in the recent months.
It's true.
They're going out and they're soliciting landowners for solar farms, what we term solar farms, okay? We're talking large solar projects. Our local zoning, we have, when we did the EV stations last year, 2 years ago, okay, we also did a simplified site plan waiver for solar, okay, on all buildings, and or on parking lots, as long as they were paved and did not increase the stormwater runoff. I don't know how many of you were here when we did that, but that's in our code. It's 140,
51.3, I think. So here we're talking the big things, okay? In your packet, you are going to find a lease agreement. In your spare time, read the lease agreement. Understand what it says, because it's great for the solar company and not very good for the landowner. Basically, what it's telling, he's saying, is that, yep, we're going to lease your land. I'm a farm. Great, we can make some money on our farm. We can lease some of our land. They can use it for solar. And in your packet, there's also information on, don't know if I put it in this packet or if I put it in the Ag and Markets packet. I think in your Ag and Markets packet, there's a small thing on solar and wind generation. Mm-hmm. So you can reference back to that in regards to this as well. Great, I can make some money. I signed this particular contract, and it turns out that they can pick and choose anywhere on my land that they are going to put their solar farm. Hmm. If I have a barn in their way because it's on an optimum spot, they can take my barn down. Okay, and then this is one company in particular. I'm not saying that they're all like this. This was presented to us in a conference. It also, one of the things that this also says is that if I decide I want to sell my farm to my child for $10, they have the first right of refusal at that price.
The company does?
Yes. And this is a 20-year lease. So, and they also acknowledge that, you know, if I'm a farmer and I put up a solar farm with one of these companies, I will lose my ag exemption.
Right.
Okay, so let's say I have a $15,000 ag exemption on my farm, and they pay me $1,000 an acre, and they're only using 5 acres. I'm only getting paid $5,000. I'm actually losing 10. So these may not be the best thing for people, but people also have to make their own choices. Having said that, you're also going to find in your packet a synopsis of a fire research report that was done, okay, for firefighter safety and emergency response, okay. The final report was 93 pages. I just gave you the top sheet. You can go to nfpa.org, which is listed on the page if you want to read it. Tom, I think you were copied on this email. So you also have in your packet a copy of the local zoning law from the town of Tonawanda, which is up in the Buffalo region, okay, for development considerations pertaining to solar skyscape, large solar farms. It's kind of in here if you want to take a look at it. It's just a law. A local law. I'm not saying this is the type of law that we should look at and adopt. It's a local law. We can look for other, you know, things. These solar companies are trying to say that they're utilities. They're not utilities. They're private companies. Okay. The way our local law stands right now, they're not permitted. It's not specific. But they're not listed in the use table. I do not consider them a utility. So therefore, if they're not in the use table, they're simply not permitted.
So is there a size that's, is it different between just putting a couple solar panels on your house and then a whole farm?
Yes.
Where's that? Like, I don't know.
Well, that's in
it's probably in there somewhere.
Yes.
In the workshop that I went to.
Yeah. I was leaving that to you, Mark.
Okay, workshop that.
Which you also have, you have the PowerPoint.
You have the PowerPoint, and I just kind of walk through it. But they had up to 12 kW solar, and they said that's a building inspector type of thing, residential type of use on it. And then it goes up to bigger sizes. Generally, the cutoff is 2 megawatts or 2,000 kilowatts.
switches over into the utility grade system that requires a major interconnection. But it raises some issues. They're working on, and I know a number of the towns in Ulster County are working on a solar energy zoning code model. This group that presented from Pace Law School is also working on a model zoning code. It wasn't clear how far along they were or when it would be, but I think within some time this year we'll get it out from them on it. But it raises some interesting things, and one of them is the size, one is aesthetics, where it is, how it looks, what kind of resolution you want on it. But it talks about developing a task force to investigate what the town wants to do on it, because they bring up one is a very interesting one. You don't have enough land on your property to put in one of these arrays, and all five of us here didn't have enough property, but there is a spot on Tom's property that we could build one that would be big enough for all of us. Okay, and it's called a shared system, and it has, we're all owners, but we're not tied directly to the solar. We're using the utility as a delivery point on it, but you could get some of these requests in there to set up a separate system on it. They're not big, they're neighborhood type size.
Interesting. So like your street could just band together and just be totally solar off the grid, kind of. Huh. But right now they couldn't, because we wouldn't allow it.
Right. But again, I think that's, is it a primary use, secondary use? I mean, if they're on there to sell power, then it's a primary use on it. But if they're there to use the power internally to them, and only occasionally does it go off the system, then it's probably similar to a secondary one. But I think...
Or accessory. I mean, depending on how it's being used.
How it's being used on it.
There's this whole thing going on in Massachusetts, I believe it is. They're doing that, like, say, five houses on the end of the street. They would put up a solar thing on one guy's property, and then they would all share in the benefits of that. But then they're basically using the utility lines to transmit the power to each other. And then also it's basically creating sort of a commercial enterprise in a residential neighborhood. And it's whether that can be accessory use or if it's a... You know, how to deal with that, and can a utility, if you own your own utility company, can you be a not-for-profit? Or, you know, so there are a lot of issues with it. And there's been a lot of talk on NPR about it.
Wow, that's a lot of work.
And then there's a whole thing of like. I'm not certain about with Central Hudson, but some you probably know better. I mean, some utilities are only required to buy back a certain percentage, and they're not so. Once that cap is reached, if you could have solar cells that you can't put into the grid.
I think Central Hudson's, and I may be wrong on this number, so, but it was like 35 megawatts, and it was their cap. They wouldn't be able. They're not allowed to buy back any more than that, just like you said. But so I don't know how much they got
between part of Orange, Ulster, Dutchess. You know, you see these things going up all over the place, and
well there's net metering. There's a limit on it to how much they. Yeah.
And the way I understand it, too, those systems are approved before building permits are even issued. So the solar company on your small scale.
Yeah.
Because I can't install a system on my home
that exceeds my energy usage by a certain percentage, okay? And it's a small percentage. Central Hudson will say, no, you cannot hook up to the grid. So if my system is too big, they make the solar company scale it down. Once they get their OKs from Central Hudson based on the size, okay, then they come to us for permits. And that's for your, you know, your roof mounted or your, you know, ground individual units. So
we do have a couple of very large installations in, in the town.
We have a lot of installations in the town. Some are more visible than others.
Yeah, and some are near houses, on houses, and some aren't on houses. That's some of them are freestanding. And I think that, I don't know, there are some other concerns, like the visual.
There are a lot of concerns.
If those are reflecting light at your house, or you're looking at a sheet of glass
the glare
across the street,
there are a lot of
bunch of things like that.
Glare and trees growing and things of that sort.
And whether you can put a second story on your house because you're going to be blocking your neighbor's solar cells, or does he own that visual space? I don't know.
Are there any restrictions unique to solar besides, I know the building codes have been, where are they? they're in or out.
Where are the building codes? Well, I can't quite answer that question yet because we haven't received our books yet from the state. We're currently in a transition period on codes that we don't yet have until April, that was slightly the state, until October 3rd. Yes, solar has been addressed in the 2015 ICC codes, which the state has now adopted with a small supplement. Yes, we will be getting those regulations.
Okay, but what I heard was, from a safety point of view, was how big they can go up on a rooftop.
One of the safety issues is is there a perimeter distance for the system? So, does the system need to have a 3-foot or a 4-foot setback from the end of the roof? So that the fire department can get up on the roof and walk around it, so to speak. That has been one of the issues.
One of the issues.
What about wind and weight and all that stuff?
That's all handled through calculations by an engineer. It's a requirement of the code. That's all got to get submitted with the building permit application.
And what are they doing for waterproofing? Is sealing the fastener?
The fasteners are, it's standardized, and they get installed as per the manufacturer's installation instructions, and we hope you don't get a leak. That's why there's a benefit to ground-mounted systems, but
I know this came up at the colleges. We have a solar array there, and we had to have a disconnect on the ground for firemen take that. Is that for residential also? It's required.
Everything gets labeled, and the systems aren't as. They've come a long way with their technology. The systems used to carry DC power all the way down to the inverters. Now, I believe they all connect and change at each panel. So the wiring is a little different on most of the systems. So they're still hot, okay? They're still dangerous to firefighters, but I don't think it's as bad as it used to be.
Yeah, I think I agree with that. That's one of those correct.
And they always generate power, okay? Not enough power to maybe be useful when it's, snowing out or cloudy out. But they generate powder, they generate power from the moon and the stars, and unless you cover it with a complete blackout type of cloth or something, they will always continue to generate power.
Do we have any code restrictions that take into account things of visual impacts or side yard setbacks or anything else, or is it just...
Well, typically,
for roof mounted, you don't have the any setback issues. For ground mounted, yes, you still have your setback issues.
You're saying it's
because it's still based on the code. It's still a structure. Okay, so it can't be in the required yard. It's got to be 20 feet on the sides, you know, 50 feet front and rear.
Safety wire, I mean, like you said, ground mounted.
Everything gets labeled. Everything gets labeled according to the law. It's a building code requirement.
Yeah.
There are no additional zoning requirements for these.
Is it treated like would an array, freestanding array, be treated like a fence or like a structure? I'd say like I'm imagining one that's about 12 feet high in the town.
It's treated like it's
and so if you're across the street looking at it, you know, it reads like a building. It doesn't. It's not low like a fence. You know, it's
right. It's treated like a structure,
okay.
Not like a fence. And the thing you have to remember with solar solar panels is they have to be situated on a lot where they're going to work. Okay. So you may have people who want solar, and it just won't work on their roofs because of possibly the surrounding trees, the position of the building, so on and so forth. You know, New Paltz is right terminology. We're a zero waste community.
We're
embracing, you know, solar. We're embracing, you know, electric vehicles. We're embracing this type of technology. So when you're looking at this, you know, you kind of want to keep all that in mind. You know, how do you get the aesthetics and the safety, mm-hmm. and yet, you know, stick to, you know, what the town is looking for, you know, and their beliefs. So
yeah.
It's not an easy task.
Just to give you a range on it, size of a solar that put out, it's in the back, and it's 1 kW requires about 100 square feet. So if you have a typical 12 kW unit, you're talking 1,200 square feet of panels,
wow.
Which is, you know, size of some houses.
It's,
you know,
it's the average size of a raised ranch. Average raised ranch, one side of the roof. That gives you that visual size-wise.
And when you get into the utility size, a 2 MW project would probably require about 12 acres.
Wow.
So
they grow.
Yeah.
But yeah, we did have one. We talked about it. That's one of the reasons we looked at the large scale one. We had somebody that had 60 acres of marginal farmland, He was really a hayfield. He couldn't grow anything else on it, and was looking at putting in something in there from a solar point of view. We didn't have any code to address that issue going forward on it. So I just brought this out. I would like probably down further on the list of the other ones. I'd like to see some of the code come out from some of the other places to look at the small scale stuff and to go over it and see if there's any nuances that we should be aware of.
And what happened to the guy with the storage? Remember there was a guy that was going to storage? Did he do that?
Yes.
He did? Mm-hmm. Oh, so there's one we could potentially go whatever came up that we wanted to.
If you got an airplane and flew over it.
Well, maybe even less.
Is that on 299?
No.
No, extra storage space on South Pump.
Oh, okay. I know where that is.
But he didn't do all his buildings. He only did a couple.
Yeah, he didn't do the whole thing.
Yeah, it's larger than your average home, but it's not a large-scale project. When I was out in North Carolina, there was a farm in the hills near Asheville. And it was very well done. And by the time I realized what it was, I really only saw two panels. So there is a place for them. It can be done if it's done right and in the right location. It's whether we feel we have any of those locations.
And it's something people want to do. I mean, we, you know.
Well, like I said, it goes up. The price is still coming down on the equipment. It's getting more efficient. It's getting, you know, better. Like, for instance, DC going to the inverter. Now it's doing stepwise. And they're lasting longer. And you'll find people that will put them up there on your house without any cost to you.
Decommissioning is a big thing, so you really have to think about decommissioning. What happens when someone has to change out their panels?
Yeah.
Or someone no longer wants to use the system because the system is broken, they can't afford to fix it.
Or
what
it's
happens
outmoded.
Then? So, or if there's, you know, a fire in a structure, and the structure is condemned, what happens to the system? Okay, I can tell you that you can't just throw them in a landfill.
Yeah.
These are rare earth type. Rare earth type elements in cells.
Yeah, so they have to be disposed of properly.
It's kind of like with the signs, where we're dealing with technology that's changing really fast, and how do we make a code that allows for that but works for now?
I think, you know, again, from standpoint, we've seen a lot of roof-mounted solar installations on it, but as it continues on, what we're trying to do is see if there's some ground rules that we should be aware of in installing these things, so we have intelligent questions.
Like
the question, is it 12 foot high, is it 6 foot high, 4 foot high? I mean,
we were actually informed last week during our code update classes that we're going to see a lot more solar shingles.
Oh yeah, I've heard that.
It's photovoltaic shingles.
Yep, so photovoltaic shingles. So that's coming down the pike. Apparently it's coming quickly for them to mention it to us. So
I don't know if you on 208 South, I don't know if you guys know, there, I think there's like a bunch of houses in a row that all have solar, because they all have big signs, but at night they're like all outlined in this fluorescent blue light. It's so weird looking. It's like they figure they're saving so much energy. They're like the whole house, like there's a couple of houses in there, it's insane looking. But anyway, they have huge solar things. It's not in New Paltz, it's like in, whatever the town is, like south of Gardner.
Rungup.
Something like that. Yeah, it's wild looking.
So,
it's a lot of houses that are all solar.
You notice them in groups.
Yeah.
It's like somebody's got one person on it and then is able to say, hey, your neighbor has one, and shouldn't you? And so you see that. But I think it's coming. Stacy brought up the landowners. It's countywide, as far as I know, of developers asking and talking to farmers about leasing their property for solar development on it. The other thing, saving race, I would think, for New Paltz is when it comes to tying into Central Hudson system, electric transmission lines, we don't have a heck of a lot. And they're all on the other side of the thruway.
Just about, yeah, I think they're just about all.
They're all out of Ohioville substation of 299, and they head north. So there's nothing really going east and west through the town.
There's a little bit, but not much.
Yeah.
We've got transmission lines that run across the thruway, down north of Shivertown and out that way. Down
right.
To 32.
Yeah.
And that's why, you know, there was a potential for a project, but because it was closer to those transmission lines. But, you know, even the town itself looked at maybe doing something, you know, at the former landfill, and we can't get the energy from the landfill to the substations.
Wow.
It has to go all the way to the substation. We can't go into it.
I don't know the full extent of what is necessary, but we just, you know, kind of ran into a snag there. You know, the governor is pushing for so many kilowatts of solar to be erected in New York State within the next few years. Unfortunately, I don't think he has spoken to the utilities about it. So.
Oh, they have incentives to connect. I just think that the logistics of trying to connect, just like you said, you run into, here's a good ideal place to put a solar farm, but there's no place to tie it into the grid system.
And the utility won't help you with that. They say, well, if you've got to run your lines, you're going to run lines. But some of these large solar companies, if they have a big enough farm, they will run the lines. So, you know, we were, you know, the project we were speaking about, that was a private individual, okay, that was looking to do this. We're talking these companies, they're major players. You know, they have very, very deep pockets. So, and there is a benefit to the community with some of these solar farms too. So as you read through the material that you have, you'll see there is a benefit to the community. Is it as high as they're claiming it is? We're not really sure yet. I don't think anybody really knows. I can tell you there's a couple of really large, really, really large projects out on Long Island that were built in the floodplains and in wetlands that worked out really well for them because it really didn't disturb a whole lot.
Right.
The way they were installed. But there is benefit to the community for these as well. So, you know, and it's something you can also look at, you know, for new subdivisions. You know, if we're zero waste community, we like solar, you know, something similar to like you were discussing, like they're doing in Massachusetts. If you have a cluster plan, okay, you got everything up, you got a lot of land around it, you pick an area for community, you know.
You don't have any large plans. Nobody's come to talk to you about any large solar project.
Yes, they have, and I've told them that it's not permitted within the town under the current regulations.
So they could be waiting for us to decide.
And those are also, larger projects.
Yes.
There's in the village that zero place, I don't know if it's solar or what they're talking about, right where
STS
yeah, was. I don't know what. I can't remember. Yeah, what is it?
It's all on the building.
Yeah, that's New York Solar. They're a local solar company, and they do solar installations.
But it gets you up to speed. Read all the material on that one. What we'll hope to see before next couple of months is some model ordinances that deal with it to take a look at and see if we need modifications. And because again, this is another, like I said, technology that's coming. More and more, you want to be able to have a handle on it. Okay. I thank you, Stacy, for coming. I have a couple of minor things I want to just accomplish tonight. I've talked with Mike Dimitrovitz at ENCB. We're going to have a joint meeting at our next workshop in May. With them, if you have any topics, agenda items you wish to talk with the ENCB on, let's get them to me so I can get Mike's going to work up an agenda on it. I'm going to the Transportation Committee tomorrow night and request that we have a joint meeting with them in June at our workshop. It's on the agenda. So. I think it's just nice to meet the people and talk about some, because I read some of their minutes and wow, I didn't know that was going on or to that effect on it. So I think just communication going back and forth. I would like to get somebody from DPW down for it and just basically say, look, we get these traffic studies and level of service and yeah, I can read the letters on it, but what do you guys look at when you get a traffic study? What should we be looking at when we get a traffic study on it? And what are some of the highlights on it and things that we should be aware of? So those are the next two workshops that I hope we have going forward. So again,
transportation, if there is something that we want to talk about, I think we can't get too site specific with DOT. The DOT rep is just a rep, is not the voice of DOT. And the same thing, I wouldn't want to put the DPW guy on the spot because he's not the voice of the entire department on it. But general terms and general information on it would be helpful. We do have a request from Talaferro's subdivision for the one that's out of sync with everybody else for an extension. They're up to date on their escrow account. I think they're just still trying to work on that conservation easement and see who they can get it with and see where we go on there. So I'll accept a motion for an extension of the Talaferro subdivision. Thank you.
Second.
Thank you. Any further discussion?
So it would be 90 days from today. That would be.
Yeah.
That would be about. July.
Come again.
We're on to July 11th, maybe.
Okay.
Minus one day or something. So.
All right, so the July 11th meeting, we're getting back. Bohunk.
We didn't finish our motion.
Oh, yes, that's right.
All those in favor?
All those in favor?
Aye.
Those?
Thanks.
Some storage isn't there. Okay, my Mohawk thing is really quick. So we got those memos in our email today from the citizens of the Shuangong people. And one of the things that they said was that they've been contacting us and they've spoken in the public comments and we've never responded to them. And I feel like we have. I think that that's the purpose of the public comment is people talk and then we get a record of it and then we, you know, respond in our documents that we've written up. But I wonder if it would be useful just to have on the record to have our lawyer or someone draw up just a, because they copied all their, you know, documents and everything, just like a 2-page or I don't know, 5-page or whatever memo saying like responses to some of the things that they said. Because I do get the sense that they feel that they're just saying the same things over and over again and we're ignoring them. That's not how I feel. I feel like we're really taking those things into consideration and really discussing them and have really done that for years now. But I feel like we have this, you know,
she said. Carol is going through the 100 pages of email letters on it, citing out what issues have been raised and going into the part 3 and citing how we address those issues.
Great.
I know it's a lot of work, but if she wrote her document with line numbers, then she could reference.
I'll go back. I'm going to see her.
A legal document where you say, okay, page such and such, line 30, that's where we address that. And then puts it sort of to bed. Like the other thing they were saying was that Dave Clouser's business had been sold to somebody who was actually representing Mohawk, but Dave Clouser. It's been Rody, Swick, and Andrews, right?
Right.
So
Dave has recused himself.
I didn't understand where that was coming from. But.
Yeah, it's stuff like that where like, you know, there's.
Okay.
Something
else
they said that was funny.
Just to catch up to speed, Tom and I had at least it was a sunny day. Met out with Chris Marks. And highway superintendent and Mohawk Preserve folks, Ted and Glenn. Basically, what I wanted to do is kind of address a couple of things from a site plan point of view. They intend to make a T intersection of Glenet B Lane where it comes into Gatehouse. And so I wanted to see how that T looked and what was on either side of it and what they intended to do there. And from Tom's point of view, whether we get the fire truck in there or on the T. So they showed us basically how they were going to tee it off. They proposed putting fencing, and what I mean by fencing, it's in one of the diagrams. It's
about 2 feet high, Tom? About that.
It's a 2 foot high post and a rail on that. They talked to Chris about where to locate that fencing. And they were looking at, I think at that site on Gatehouse Road, they were looking at about a 2 foot off pavement to put the fencing up. Chris was comfortable with that, you know, it's a town right of way, that it wouldn't be an issue with plowing, but it would also minimize people parking because you could not park around there without being on pavement.
Sneaky.
Okay. And that one would go right around the and to the end of the intersection. Chris is working on filling out and doing the paperwork requiring and sending it up to DPW for his action of teeing off the Gatehouse Road with 299. He's talked with them on it. They don't seem to have any problem with it. But he still has to do the paperwork.
What about those two driveways to the east?
There's only one that he has.
I thought there were two.
There's two driveways to say yes. Horseshoe Drive. And apparently someone
was the same resident.
Same residence.
But on the map, it showed on two lots.
Oh, there's two lots side by side, but where the entrance is coming out, it's not going to affect one of the driveways.
Okay.
And he hasn't been able to get hold of those people, but secondhand from a neighbor that said they had no problem with what he was proposing to do. But again, it's that on. We talked about, I'll call it the turnaround. Out 299 is a spot off of 299. It looks like it's a turnout. It's just a gravel area there on the side of the road. And Tom brought up the point about somebody driving down the road and say, oh, we just missed Mohawk. Oh, here's a turn, and go in there and do a U-E. What Mohawk has agreed with and work with DPW to find out where the dividing line is and get rid of that gravel and green it up with grasses there so it doesn't look like that at all.
It's not. Is it near Gatehouse Road or?
No. It's right off 299. If you go past where they're talking about turning into
between the parking area. Gatehouse and Albany Post on the right.
Right. Yeah.
There's two. Actually,
there's one on the right and the left.
One on the right and one on the left.
Yeah, I can't do much on the left. I don't know that, but at least on the right side on it, we're going to minimize that so it doesn't look like that. We'll fix that up. But he'll work with DPW to find out what he can do. And
the police will have no place to park.
then we took a ride out to Lenape and Butterville Road and discussed the issues out there. One of the things that they show on their site plan is on their washing, on their trail by Butterville, they had a fence. It was a split rail fence that was at the end of the trail. So there'd be the fence that blocked off the farmland, and then there'd be another fence between the road itself and the trail, just a split rail to show where the trail was going. We talked about that, actually, there was three cars, I think, the time when we were out there anyway, parked along the side of the road there. And we talked about using the same concept of that fencing, that 2 foot high fence.
Like a guardrail fence?
Yeah, like a guardrail fence. Along Butterville Road,
rather than out by, rather than do it by the trail, put that guardrail fence out by Butterville Road. Well, where should we put it? We looked it off. Chris was comfortable, because we had him there, with being 6 foot off pavement. It's still in the town right away, but it's approximately 6 feet off the pavement.
So if you were 6 foot, would be narrow enough that people wouldn't be able to get their door open and be parked off the traffic lane?
We were saying the cars were about 8 foot wide, so even if they put it right up against the guardrail fencing, they'd still have tires on the front pavement.
Mike, can I ask a silly question?
Oh, of course. This is the place to do it.
A 2 foot high rail, okay? If that ends up being a maintenance issue because people pull off the road and are continuously hitting this 2 foot high wood fence, and they want to change it to a higher fence because it's a constant maintenance issue, it's getting run over, okay? They're gonna have to come back to the planning board for site plan amendment. It's not really a question, it's a factual statement, but I'm just questioning that we really think that through.
Well, we thought it through from the parking aspects on it. It saves the pavement because that's where it breaks up when people pull off and then get back on pavement. That's where
I don't disagree with the location at all. I'm just a little concerned about the height. Not people not being able to really see it. You know, once they get to a certain point, they're not going to see it over the hoods of their cars, or they're going to be whacking it with their doors, because people will still try to park, and they will park there, they will park on pavement, and the cops will come and give them tickets, and, you know, it's still going to happen.
All right.
You know, it's going to take a while for people to realize they really can't park there.
Because there was a drop off there, was Stacy Sands, if it goes lower.
It's just you know, something that I, you know.
All right, that's the kind of conversation we had. I mean, we were working on the location.
You know, if they go with the 2 foot high fences, there's something that we could have put on the site plan, maybe, that, you know, if there's a continuous maintenance problem and they can prove it to the code official, and they need to raise the height of it or something, maybe in the resolution.
Yep.
You know, something along those lines, just so that if we find that we're having a constant maintenance issue, because the maintenance issue is also going to become an enforcement issue, because if the fence isn't kept up, then we have to go after them to fix the fence. So, you know, maybe somewhere in your resolution.
What's the normal height for the guardrail?
I don't know.
I think it's about bumper on the steel ones. It would be around bumper, so it might be 24.
That's a good question to ask, because the way Chris is talking, when he was talking about plowing snow, I thought he was talking the normal guardrail height.
Yeah.
So,
all right, we'll pursue that one. Thanks. I think that's a good point. We didn't think of that. We talked about
metal, and they get hit all the time. This is a wood split rail fence.
Well, he was comfortable. They would know how to plow.
Oh, no, I was worried about the highway. I'm not worried about the highway. I was
worried about everybody else.
The daily maintenance and the daily, you know, abuse that it's going to take.
Well, take a look at that. And tweak that. But that was the idea, that it would be, he was comfortable with putting it in 6 foot off pavement along the part of the road. And that would, again, from a car point of view, even if you put it up against the fence, you would still be at 2 wheels on pavement. So
they felt like a steel guardrail would be too expensive.
Well, in keeping with
the
aesthetics of it.
And that's what's nice about the 2 foot high, is that it's really not going to get into your view shed.
No.
You know.
So, but maybe we'll talk about that and see about it. So anyway, Chris was comfortable with them. I think The preserve was comfortable with moving the fence line to effectuate that, and would save the issue of parking. I did get a note from Glenn today that I guess there was a lot of parking up on 4455 this past weekend on the road.
Because the state park was closed.
Because Minnewaska was closed. Mm-hmm. There was a fire in Sands Point. So they closed. Mm-hmm. All the Minnewaska people parked on the road. So that was, he informed me. I wasn't up there, so I didn't see that. But in case somebody mentions to it, that's what the reason was. Okay, so.
Also talked about the entranceway with the possibility of a gravel shoulder in between into the entrance.
Right. One of the questions, and just for coming to the entrance to the parking area, you know, if you have, say, a bus or something else like that, of making that turn into the parking area there, that they would hard pack the shoulder, so if the bus or what have you came off pavement or somebody, they would have, you know, something solid there on it. So he will work with the county to hard pack that that shoulder area and move the drainage. They already moved the drainage basically off that, so up a little bit further into the site, so we'll run down, and that low point will still be on their property where it will drain off.
So there's a culvert there, right, at the entrance?
Yeah.
So we'll have to extend that.
Well, the county, I believe, is making them put a culvert in anyway, in case they needed the turning lane.
So that was the, we got out and did that. How we do on OSI's field trip? Anybody?
I think you're the only one who RSVP'd so far.
Okay. I just...
It didn't work. Those dates didn't work.
Okay. I
would like to do it.
What do you? Which day are you saying?
I was going Friday night.
Friday night? This coming Friday?
The 29th, yeah.
I could come. What time is it?
Was it 5:30? Kelly, 5:30?
5:30.
And meet
at the boat launch? Or?
The boat launch?
Yes.
Yeah.
Okay, 5:30 at the boat launch. I can do that.
Or Saturday at 9:30.
I love the Augusta's response.
Peter said he
would. I'd love to do it, but.
I still don't want to do it. I rewrote that like 5 times and don't seem so stressed out.
It seemed like it. I was tired after I finished reading.
You know, I get so many people on a stopper.
Oh.
Is that supposed to be more than 3 of us anyway, huh?
As long as we don't take action. We'll just,
you know. Yeah, you can, yeah.
We can meet as a group there on that, but. Okay.
Can I ask you a question?
Certainly.
On the speed limit on 299, I know we've had conversations that we have to, the town board has to approve it. You know, what steps do we have to go? Because I'm still having that as a stumbling block.
Yeah, seriously.
Seriously.
I agree with Tom.
I agree too.
I will, that's one of the other reasons I'm meeting with the transportation committee tomorrow night, is to define who's got the lead and what we have to do on it. And really, because it's outside of my area of expertise of filling in the form. But if I got to fill in the form, I'll fill in the form and the process it through. But I think I need their backing on it. But I was trying. The transportation committee to go to the town board for it.
But that shouldn't be that hard to get their backing. I mean, are they? I mean,
no, are they speed freaks? I've been on the TIC committee since last year, And yeah, it'll be good for you to come tomorrow night. There have been discussions. It's not a simple task.
No, that's...
Well, we keep hearing that.
And
I've got it.
Right, and once the recommendation gets put forward to the town board to make the recommendation to the DOT, because that's where it's going to go, you'll need to follow up with the town board.
Yeah, I don't mind carrying the water. It's just I don't know. Again, I'm not the expert on.
Well, Tom Weiner, who works for the DOT, also sits on the committee, and he's a community member as well, which really helps us as community as a whole. So he'll be a point person.
Because here's my thoughts. I may be off base, but Mohonk has to go to DOT for permission to put a driveway cut into the parking area. Therefore, that is going to create an additional hazard or additional traffic into that area. Why can't they look at it as a total package? I mean, if they're looking, they have to approve the turnoff. They need to look at the speed limit also, because that turnoff, the entranceway, is going to affect that entire stretch of road.
Well, I think,
and they have to look at it as a whole project, not pieces of it.
But that's how you see it. How do we get them to see it that way?
I think
Tom will explain how they look at these things to you.
And I'll get back to you. Actually, they're pretty good on the minutes on it, but I'll get back to you on how that transpires, what we have to do, and how do we do it, and what's necessary for it also. Do we have all the information that they need to process the request? Or are they looking for something additional from us or not? I'll find out tomorrow night.
And I have one additional question, which was posed to me over the weekend. Traffic study, one day only? Normally when you do a study of anything, you take the various times, various conditions. And this is not coming from me, this was asked to me by a taxpayer. It's how can you determine the effects of a project of 365 days a year in one day, in an hour and a half, or 2 hours, whatever it
was? That's what they did with CVS also. They did the same thing. It was a one day, couple of hours traffic study. I asked that question them too.
From my point of view, I think this, you go out and you take counts, and you take project counts, and you've seen the clickers in the road on it, and they're not every peak day or everything else. I think they take those things and then project from that what the peak traffic is at certain hours of the day.
But once, just to go out once, that's what I asked that
question. Oh, I know, it's accumulation.
It doesn't make sense to do this one day at one time.
According to our traffic study, it's just that it shows it was done one day.
Yeah. I mean, we could ask Ken that, ask him to explain that to us, the methodology.
Well, that's one of one of the things with the...
Actually, I think there were two. There was one in May and one in October. But what they do is they take the count, and they have this big handbook, like 700, 800 pages. So it gives some communities, it gives them size communities, typical communities where they've done these studies. And they say, this is what the peak hour... This is when the peak hour is, 3 to 5 or whatever And for this size of community, of this type of... industry or whatever it is, they look it up in the table and they go, okay, here's what we're looking for. This is part 2B or something. This is your Saturday, 1 o'clock is your weekend peak time. So they go out and they measure it at that time, and they extrapolate.
They extrapolate the pattern of traffic on various roads. Obviously, DOT and DPW take traffic counts on various roads at various times, and not everything is on the peak day or the peak hour of every road. Just don't have enough equipment to do something like that. So there has to be some sort of analysis that drives them from taking a count on a Tuesday at 4 o'clock to what it would be on a Saturday at 1 o'clock. I mean, otherwise, traffic studies would have to be out 365. What it is, how it is, I can't explain it, but I figured there is a way, and I'll ask tomorrow night, and then just for the edification, I'll check with Ken also on how these traffic counts are. I'll be right up in paragraph, but yeah, it's the estimates are based on traffic counts taken at particular times of the day and then ratioed up to peak and off peak.
Because on the one that was done for this, it was on October 18th, Columbus Day weekend.
Yeah.
Every member of the west of Walk Hill or anybody west of that avoids that road completely.
Yeah.
So,
yeah.
But on a normal weekday or weekend, you have local traffic using that road.
But when's the peak?
You don't. You really don't know. You need a median onto it. You can't get that from one test.
Well, if I think what they took it on, White Reserve did it on October 18th, was that was the peak day, Columbus Day, where all their parking lots are filled, where Minnewaska is filled, and they get the most traffic those days, and that's why they took it. And like you said, the neighbors get out of town fast on those days. And
well, if traffic is backed up to Woodleyville Road, they turn around and they go back.
Yeah.
And I see that all happen all the time. It's just, I just can't, this person could not understand why at least 3 days, various parts of the year wasn't tested. We had the same conversation with Wilmerland on the days that they took their traffic counts. I mean, if you're basing a decision onto it, I think, you know, it needs to be more than one day.
But I do think it's good they took it on, like, the busiest day. Even if there wasn't local traffic, I still think there was so much traffic that it maybe...
Right. All Tom wants to know is how do they take a two-hour reading, or how do they take a two-hour reading on a weekday and project out what the traffic peak traffic is in the time? And like I go with Lyle, there is a methodology that's beyond my understanding because I've never done how they get there. And it's definitely.
It's what I always wonder is if that's the peak. Is it considered a real peak or is it just a little bump? Because our perception is it's all bad.
And
the difference between all bad and worse is a fine line. You know?
Well, they have to be able to tell the difference between levels of service, so there has to be some pattern to bring that into. But again, one of the reasons to meet with the Transportation Committee and DPW and DOT is kind of get these questions out. That's what I just said. We read a traffic study, and you took the reading on October 18th. How do you know what it is for the rest of the year? Or when do you know it's peak day? How do you read that into the numbers?
Was it raining?
What the weather conditions are, and how do they draw from that? Those are the kinds of questions we're not experts on, and we don't have that in there. But
it was funny. I think it was a couple of years ago. I put the date in my phone because I'm driving on North Putt Corners coming to 299, and I see the traffic tubes going across the road, and they had just paved the road and they hadn't even striped it yet. So that, like, there's no way that was anything typical of your average traffic, you know. But they still have the tubes out there. Somebody had said, go put them out there on such a date.
One team that does the traffic count as opposed to the team that does the paving of the roads and a work schedule on it. Yeah.
But I make the left-hand turn on going east on 299 from North Pike several times a day, and I find that like the backup is we're getting way back close to that that hill, you know?
The null?
I mean, the people getting over onto the suddenly painted striped island type thing all the way back to make the left-hand turn. I know they're extending that as part of the project, but I don't know if it'll be enough.
Well, we have
any CVS news?
I'm meeting with the town supervisor and them on a phone call tomorrow.
Cool.
But basically, we both told them that nothing goes on CVS until we bring the escrow up to date.
Yeah.
So Kelly's on the hook to see, let me know when the check arrives.
A concern, as you know, that this the other store, the Stop and Shop, I believe it is maybe closing or
well,
for another vendor.
It's just Barry, you know more about it than I do. So.
But you know, it seems a shame that we're gonna have we might wind up with a vacant building, and we're building another building that might someday wind up being vacant.
Nobody likes to move into a vacant. No. It appears that these big stores want to build their own store.
But the good news for them is the Stop and Shop closes and there goes one drugstore in town.
That's right.
Another school, there's still like three, I think just not four.
And that drugstore got absorbed when they put in the Stop and Shop, remember?
Yeah, it was Baxter.
Yeah, yeah, and they got absorbed as part of the deal. So
don't know what's happening on that. I think that you know more than I do on that one. I just read what you write, so that's as far as I know.
I just have one note for the planning board. In December, when the town changed the floodplain regulations, the town board had done so at the request of the planning board that they would go back and they would relook at subdivisions. Okay. We have a new board. This board did not enact those laws. So I think a follow up from the planning board is warranted on that issue.
Subdivision part of it.
It was only the request was only the subdivision regulations.
Oh, okay.
There were some additional things that you wanted to look at, or you wanted the town board to look at the time.
Yeah, I'll go back and refer to that.
So that needs to be readdressed with the current law.
I think my going to our moratorium is still in effect, or is it? How's that expired too? There's a couple of them. But I'll take a look at what we got outstanding.
I mean, there's no particular rush with that other than that was, it's just a housekeeping item.
You don't have anything for you for a subdivision?
Not yet.
You expecting something?
Okay. I didn't forget them all. Well, I forgot two out of three. We didn't make a motion at the last meeting to forward OSI's application to Ulster County Planning Board. So I'd like to get a motion to forward OSI's River to Ridge Trail to the Ulster County Planning Board.
So moved.
Okay, any discussion? All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Talk about OSI's long form. Help, help. OSI's long, wetlands long form?
Yeah, they wanted to know if everybody wanted a paper copy.
Oh!
We don't
have a copy. We got a notice from OSI that they could. It's a big file, and they want to know if you wanted all paper copies, or would you be willing to take a...
They have a searchable PDF.
I was just going to say, can we make sure it's searchable?
Yeah.
No, who cares?
All right. Okay, just save the trees. Okay, so we'll get the searchable...
We'll get a copy for the office, so if somebody wants
We'll get a hard copy for
we'll
that.
Get
it's just
hard
for
hard copies.
It's just for... you guys to take a look at. Oh, I knew there was something else. Okay, so we're okay with that too. That's it. Have a motion to adjourn. Hey,
do you want to hear a funny thing? I was talking to my landlord in New York City, who said, First of all, zoning districts, there's a million everywhere.